this Maggi is now holding all the vegetables together. It's made a kind of a gel in which the vegetables are all trapped. Okay, that's more or less what the matrix is like. Right, the image on the left hand side is actually real cells that are held in the matrix. And as you can see, the blue is the matrix, the red is the cell. And what you can see is this very, you know, extensive strands that are coming to wrap the cell up, right? And like all these vegetables, you know, this matrix comes together to hold all the cells together, right? And it's everywhere, you know, it's covering the cell on all sides, right? So next time you think of, you have a bowl of Maggi, you know, you're going to remember the fact that in your body as well, there is something that seems to be doing this.
There is one question from Vineet, where he asks, are there effects of temperature or radiation on our matrix?
Right. So, see, the way the matrix is assembled is very temperature dependent, right? So when I showed you this Maggi, matrix Maggi, right? Remember that this matrix comes together at your body's temperature, which is 37 degrees, right? If you take that matrix out, and you know, we can purify the matrix, not from humans, but you know, from mouse cells, or even from some animals, you can isolate the matrix, right? And now if you allow the matrix to assemble, that is form this Maggi, right? At 37 degrees, it will have certain properties. If you do the same thing at 20 degrees, it will assemble, but it will have slightly different properties, right? So remember, a lot of what cells do, you know, how they function, what kind of matrix they secrete, how that matrix assembles is all dependent on the temperature, our physiological temperature, which is 37 degrees, right? So that's vital to everything that that cells do. Shall we continue?
Yeah, I think one more question, Nagaraj, because Nirali has been asking this again and again, is can we be born, are there people born with no matrix? Can there be something like a congenital deficiency of matrix?
It's a very good question. So it's unlikely that there is no matrix at all. Okay, yes. Because if there is no matrix at all, chances are the embryo will not develop, right? But there are diseases where the composition of the matrix, right? So it's one particular kind of matrix protein may not be optimal, right? And there are harmful effects that the body feels as a result of it, okay? What is also interesting is diseases like, for example, cancers, right? The way the matrix is made and how that matrix is put together is also very different, right? So people are increasingly studying, and today at the end, you know, I'll show you something about how the matrix can influence, you know, something that we all probably know about, which is a heart attack, right? And we've all heard of a heart attack, and how this matrix contributes to what happens there, right? So, go ahead.
So Nagaraj, the questions are just so outstanding. That Vineet has asked a question, is staying young forever means to have matrix intact? Is the matrix the elixir of immortal youth?
yeah. Good question, right?
Look at the question.
You know, all all these, you know, commercial creams that are available, right, which sell this dream of you being youthful, you know, even as you age. Right. If you read carefully, among the things that they actually contain is a matrix protein that we just talked about, which is collagen. Okay, the collagen is the matrix protein that actually, you know, right, helps our skin stay as soft as it does. Right. So one of the things is you know, to see whether you can actually replenish some of the collagen, not all of it, and if that can contribute to you keeping your skin soft, right? So it's a very superficial thing, but you're right. You know, if you want to stay healthy, it's not just about your skin. It's also about your internal organs, right? So is it possible that, you know, how the matrix changes and preventing that change from happening could have an important role in allowing us to maybe not stop aging, but at least delay aging in some sense, right? And this is a very important question that a lot of people are actually thinking about, right? Just as they are thinking about diseases and their connection to matrix, they're also thinking about aging and its connection to the matrix. It's a good question.
Okay, I think we can move on. We'll come back to questions in some time later.
Okay. So what I wanted to kind of next show you is what happens when a cell attaches. See, I told you there is matrix. I also told you this matrix attaches cells attach to that matrix using these hooks, which are integrins. There is supposed to be a movie there, Snehal. Can you see if there is a movie that you can play? Yeah, it's playing. Okay. So does it play?
Just a minute, Nagraj. I'm trying to make it play. I guess I just click on it. Oh, no, it's opening, it's Nagraj.
Okay.
Maybe it won't play from this, though I've downloaded it as a PPT itself. If I click on it, okay. It's opening to the original link. Would you like to play it from there?
Yeah, I could play it from here. It's there on the online file. I did check.
Yeah, I think if we have Nagraj share his screen, he might be able to play it, because if the videos are on his Gmail drive, they won't play when we download it.
So Nagraj, I've made you co-host. Okay. I've made you co-host. Okay. So now you can share your screen. Guys, you can keep typing in your questions while we sort out this brief technical issue.
Let me just open the file so that I have it here.
Try clicking the space bar, says Akhil. Which is the space bar? I'm not sure. Oh, space bar here, I guess. No, Akhil, it's not working for some reason.
That's okay. I will see if I can do it from here.
Yeah. The long button on the bottom. Okay, yeah, look at that. We're getting like live real-time feedback. Customer service center has never been so good.
Can you see this?
Yes, we have. Absolutely. Wonderful. Okay. Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you.
So if you take cells and you put them on a matrix, you know what happens? I think my favorite example of this is, I think we've all seen a chapati being made, right? It begins with a ball of dough, right? And then it spreads out, right? And for the chapati to go from this to this, among the things that you have to do is apply force, right? You have to use a balan and, you know, apply force on the dough and spread it, which allows for the chapati to become nice and round and flat. Right. And that's kind of what cells do. Right. So this is a movie of a real skin fibroblast cell that begins as a round dough. OK. And keep watching it as it spreads now. Right. It will take a minute or so, but you can see the cell starts making all these, you know, tiny protrusions, you know, things that it is putting out. And then it starts spreading. Right. You can see the nucleus. You can see all the other organelles which are inside, which are all moving about, right? And the cell is now beginning to stretch, right? And it's stretching to become evenly spread out like this chapati is, right? Now, the interesting thing here is for a chapati to go from this to this, okay, you need to apply force from outside. For a cell which was round to begin with, to go from that to this, okay? I think what we really need is the cell actually uses force from inside the cell, right? So the fact that the cell is stuck and is holding on to the matrix now allows for the cell to push, apply force from inside and stretch the cell in such a way, that the chapati would be stretched because of the force that we apply from outside. Right. So the cell, and that happens because of the ability of these receptors to hold on to the matrix and, you know, move the cell in all directions to make it go from you know, this round ball, I'll just play this again once, you know, this round ball of a cell where it was to begin with. And eventually you will see it covers almost, you know, 3/4 of this image. That's how well, you know, the cell spread, right? And this is a real, you know, skin, human skin fibroblast cell that is attaching and spreading, right? Now, this kind of ability of cells to attach to a matrix, okay, and hold on, and grip and pull and push, okay, is also equally important for the cells to move. Okay, I have a movie that's coming up in the next slide, which actually will show you. Let's see if this movie plays. Yeah. So what this movie is going to show you is it's going to show you this cell, which is called a macrophage. It's a cell that protects your body, right? And it's something that, you know, allows that, like so many other things that, you know, protect your body, you know, these cells are vital in fighting infections, right? And it's actually chasing a bacteria. Can you see the bacteria that's moving around, that's wriggling around? And you can see that the macrophage chases it, right? The bacteria turns left, macrophage turns left. Bacteria turns right, macrophage turns right. See, it's going to make a right turn now, right? And then it keeps following the bacteria. And eventually, it'll go eat the bacteria up. Okay? There you go, right? It engulfs the bacteria and then will digest it, right? Now, this macrophage being able to chase the bacteria, I'll play this movie again. It's a very old movie. It was made in the 1950s. And it's still quite a remarkable movie to watch even today. Okay. So it chases, left turn, left turn, left turn. Now it has to make a right turn up, a left turn again, and then eventually it engulfs it. Right. So for this kind of movement of a cell, the cell has to attach. If you have to run, for example, your feet are vital, right? They are holding or, you know, attaching themselves to the ground is vital to allow them, to allow you to move. Just like that, you know, this ability of these hoops and the matrix is what is coming together to allow these cells to move and chase a bacteria this way, okay? The other really interesting thing about cells is something that is illustrated in this image, right? There are two kinds of surfaces here, right? Now, one is a hard surface, one is a soft surface, right? And all of you have walked on hard surfaces, and all of you have walked on sand, right? And among the things that you notice very immediately is that, you know, your feet sink when you walk on sand. If you're trying to run on sand, you know that it's harder to run on sand, you know, as compared to a harder surface, you know, and that's also because when your feet hit the sand or any surface, there is a reactionary force, and that reactionary force is very vital to, you know, how you run on that surface. So because on a sand, that reactionary force is very different, you know, you need to spend more energy when you're running on sand. So people exercise on sand because, you know, it kind of, you're running on the beach, for example, you know, you burn more calories, right? So the question here is, do cells actually also sense difference in this kind of stiffness, right? Something that is hard versus something that is soft, can cells tell the difference? And the short answer is, yes, they do, right? Interestingly, I told you, along with the shape of the cells in your body, okay, shape of your tissues, like a heart has a very distinct architecture, the brain has a distinct architecture. Along with that, what is also interesting is that these tissues all have very distinct stiffness. A whole bunch of tissues here, right? Brain, lung, liver, muscle, bone. And you're looking at their stiffness, which is measured in something called gigapascal, right? Pascal or gigapascal. Saying what you know, these tissues all, you know, vary in their stiffness. That means, you know, some tissues can be softer, some tissues can be harder, right? Which means the cells that make up the tissue, I told you the cells are fairly similar, right? But the matrix, you know, that covers these cells in the tissues, you know, could have varying stiffness. And that contributes to how the cells feel in that particular stiffness. So cells in the bone are happy, you know, being in that stiff environment. They actually do well only if their stiffness is this high. If you take cells from the bone and put them on a stiffness that is very soft, they're actually going to be very unhappy. Okay. Same is true about cells in the brain. Right? They have a certain, their environment has a certain stiffness. And if you take them and put them in something that is very stiff, right, chances are they are not going to do very well. Right. So along with being able to hold on to things, okay, what the matrix also does for cells, it allows these tissues to have very distinct stiffnesses. And that contributes to how the cells live and work in that particular tissue, right? So we'll stop here and take a few more questions then.
Yes, thank you, Nagaraj. Thank you. The videos were fascinating. So some really good questions, Nagaraj. One thing is, how was the immune cell sensing the bacterium? A lot of young minds have asked this.
Yeah.
How does it know where the bacterium is going?
Yeah. So this is a very, you know, fascinating thing, right? So as I told you, the receptor on the surface that binds the matrix is this hook, right? Similarly, there are other receptors on the surface that bind many different chemicals that are present in that environment. Okay. Now the bacteria make their own chemicals. Okay. And because the bacteria make their own chemicals, these cells have receptors that can recognize the chemical that the bacteria makes. So the cells don't have eyes, right? See, you and I, if we were chasing the bacteria, if the bacteria turns left, you can see, and so you will turn left. But these cells don't have those eyes to see where the bacteria is going. So what they see is what the bacteria secretes. So if the bacteria is, you know, secreting this chemoattractant, you know, which is something that the cells that are, you know, chasing them can bind, then if the bacteria moves left, then this cell will notice that there is a lot more chemoattractant on this side. So the receptors that are on this side of the cell are now all becoming active. Okay. The receptors on this side are not, right? Or they are less active as compared to this. So the cell now decides that based on the fact that there are more receptors that are active here than here, that the direction it has to move to is this, right? And so it goes in that direction. Now, if the bacteria moves this way, you know, again, this side receptors will become engaged. And now the cells will move in this direction, right? And so the cells are able to sense their environment and change the direction in which they move. That's a very good question.
Yes. Snehal, do you have any questions?
Yes. So there was another question regarding the video about the macrophage and the bacteria, which is, what were the other round things that were in the video apart from the macrophage and the bacteria?
Great question.
So,
Anushmita.
So those are lymphocytes, which are another cell, group of cells that are present in the blood. The macrophages are the ones. This is interesting, right? Those cells are not reacting to the bacteria. Right? Because it's only the macrophage that is chasing, which means that those cells can't tell there is a bacteria around. So there are certain cells, as I said, if the bacteria makes chemoattractant, there are certain cells that can detect that bacteria because they can detect that chemoattractant. And those are the only ones that can go chase and hunt them. Right? So the other cells are going around as if nothing's happened because they have no clue this is happening. Right? But the macrophage knows. And the macrophage is the only one that is chasing around to go find and hunt the bacteria. Very good question.
Yeah. So, Nagaraj, our young minds give undergrads and PhD students competition, you know. They're not looking only at what we pointed out. They are asking you everything else, you know.
Look at that.
That's science in action. Wonderful. Well done, Anushmita. Yes, lots of other questions.
Yes. So Lakshmi asked, how do cells talk to each other?
Okay. So obviously they talk to each other through this matrix, right? So one way is, if the cells, for example, are unhealthy, okay, the matrix is made by the cells. So they put this matrix out, right? So and the matrix is replenished, remember that, right? So it's not like it makes matrix once and that's the end of that. No, this is a living thing, right? So it keeps getting made, it keeps getting remade. And so that is the reason over a period of time in our life, as we age, the matrix changes. Because if we had the same matrix that we had when we were a small kid, you know, we wouldn't have to worry about, you know, wrinkles anymore, right? So the matrix changes through life. And so one way to communicate is through the matrix. The other way cells communicate is they secrete other things that, you know, other cells can also detect and know that the cells in their neighboring environment are reacting a certain way. The junctions that I told you about are also very vital for cell-cell communication, right? So everything from cells getting pulled, okay, or cells actually, you know, releasing chemicals that go through the cell junctions are ways by which cells actually can talk to each other.
Okay, Snehal, did you see Nirali's question? So after chemotherapy or radiotherapy, Nagaraj, does the matrix die? Is the matrix destroyed?
So it's a good question. Hmm. See, it's very unlikely that the matrix gets destroyed because that's part of the reason why the cells can come back and repopulate, right? So if the matrix had completely been destroyed, they may suffer some damage. But if the matrix was completely destroyed, it's very unlikely that these cells will be able to revive and grow and remake, you know, many of these tissues. So chemotherapy is obviously killing a lot of cells, you know, the bad cells as well as, you know, many good cells. But the matrix stays for the most part. And that's partly the reason why the repopulation of the body or the recovery of the body is possible. Good question again.
And Sneha, we'll take this final question from Anushmita and then we'll move on. Yeah.
Yes. Okay, so her question is, if the bacteria develop a system that does not send a signal to the macrophage, will our body adapt and develop a new system of detection?
Yeah, so this is the really remarkable thing, right? That bacteria have evolved over a period of time. You know, even for a new, bacteria that we are seeing for the first time, right? Like this virus that is going around that we're all fighting, you know, what is it called? Yeah, you probably heard of it, right? You know, the really remarkable thing is we are now trying to make a vaccine, right? Now the vaccine will only work if your body still has the capability to produce antibodies that can fight this virus, right? Even though it's never seen this virus, right? You know, we may have seen it in some form, maybe now, but not before. Right. So the ability of the body to adapt is really remarkable. And that's why I think even, you know, it's possible that when you encounter an organism for the first time, you know, you may suffer because your body is adapting or learning how to react to that organism. But over a period of time, we do learn. And that's what's kind of kept us or helped us survive. Right. So even now, there are many people who fall sick to varying degrees. Right. Some people fall very sick. Some don't fall very sick at all. Right. And that means their bodies are somehow able to cope with this very differently than others. So this says that the body has the ability to adapt. And that's a good observation.
Wonderful. Okay. We'll move on, Nagaraj, to the last segment, which I think is going to be the most fascinating for our young minds.
Right. So, see, I told you about the cells that line the blood vessels, right, which are called the endothelial cells, you know. So these are the endothelial cells right at the front, which are right here, right? And these are the ones that have the very tight seal, right? But the blood vessel is actually made up of many layers of cells. And, you know, a favorite example of mine is it's like a sandwich. Right. So you can see, you know, all these layers that are, you know, held together in a sandwich. That's kind of how they're all put together to make this blood vessel. You know, different kinds of cells. There is elastic, this elastic lamina, which is made up of this protein called elastin, which is an extracellular matrix protein. And that's kind of a flexible protein, right? So it's very interesting because that's what allows the blood vessels to expand, contract, right? If you feel your pulse, right, the reason you're able to feel it is because the blood vessel is able to do this, right? And that's mediated by this matrix. By elastin that is present there, right? And so you have this sandwich of cells, right? That's making up the blood vessel. Now, the reason I talk about the blood vessel is because, you know, we've all heard about this condition called a heart attack. I think many of you may know somebody who suffered a heart attack. You know, most people survive and do well after a heart attack. In some cases, if it is very severe, they could also die. You know, very recently, you know, probably one of the greatest footballers who ever played the game of football, you know, Diego Maradona, died of a heart attack, right? And he did not survive. The reason heart attacks happen is also very interesting. It's because these blood vessels get blocked, right? So imagine, you know, your blood vessel is a tunnel. I think many of you may have used a tunnel to travel, you know, through the ghats here in Pune. And, you know, in the monsoons, it happens. Sometimes there is a landslide and the tunnel gets blocked. Right. And similarly, you know, this could happen because of many reasons. You know, it could be because of the kind of diet you have. It could be, you know, lack of exercise. It could be genetic, partly in some cases. All these factors could come together to create a block in your artery. Right. So this is your open artery through which blood flows. And if that gets blocked, like here, you know, by cells, what could essentially happen is that, you know, that part of the heart to which this blood vessel supplies nutrients to starts getting damaged. And this may, the heart beats at a very distinct, you know, with a distinct rhythm. And that rhythm can be compromised, right? And effectively over a period of time, the heart may actually stop. Right. So people who suffer from a heart attack, one of the things they do is they give them a shock to kind of revive the heart and get it beating again. Right. And that's because the heart has stopped all of a sudden and you want that, you know, rhythm to be restored. And in some cases that does work. Right. But among the things that they do to fix this, OK, like if you had, you know, the Bombay-Pune expressway, which is blocked, you know, by a landslide, you know, you will get a truck with, you know, the right equipment and remove all the debris that is lying in and open up the tunnel, right? And that's what, you know, you are trying to do, you know, during a heart attack as well. Now, one of the things I wanted to point out is this disease condition that causes a heart attack has this tongue twister of a name, right, which is called atherosclerosis. So this block that you're seeing here is what's also called a atherosclerotic plaque, right? But atherosclerosis is nothing but a heart attack. And one of the ways to fix this is, you know, they use this very remarkable device, something that is actually, you know, put through a small tube, okay, through, you know, your blood vessel and goes all the way to your heart, to the place where there is a block. And, you know, once it reaches that point, they have this metal grill that you can see here, which is called the stent. And the stent is brought to the place where the artery is blocked. And they actually pump air to, you know, blow up a small balloon. Now, this balloon is interesting because the balloon fills up and opens up the stent. Now, the stent is designed in such a way that it opens. And once it opens, it cannot close. Right. So they bring it to the right place. They open it. And once it's open, you know, it stays open. And then they can shrink the balloon again and then pull it back out. Right. So they can pull it back out of your vein, out of your blood vessel. And this stent is now kept in place. And what they are doing now is that part of the reason why these plaques are formed is the kind of matrix that is deposited in these blood vessels. So really interestingly, blood vessels, you know, undergo, have a lot of different changes in shapes, right? So blood vessels divide, for example, you know, they can have a junction. And in places where there is like a junction in the blood vessel is where they have seen these kind of plaques form more often. And that's partly because of the kind of blood flow that is there and the kind of matrix that is secreted in that region. So they found that there are some matrix that actually support the formation of a plaque. And there are some matrices that actually prevent the formation of the plaque. So what they do is that this stent that they put in, they actually coat with a matrix protein that prevents new plaque from forming. So not only is the stent going there and opening up and keeping the artery open, but because it is coated by this matrix protein that prevents a plaque from forming, you know, new plaque also does not form in that area, right? So this is one very simple example of how using matrix that the cells make and, you know, putting it on a stent like this can protect the body. And it is used, you know, very regularly now to prevent new plaques from forming and new, you know, and heart attacks from being caused, right? I think that's my last slide. I'll take questions, you know, if you have any about these or anything else we discussed so far.
Oh, thank you, Nagaraj. Perfect timing. Absolutely. Vineet asks a good question, Nagaraj, right off the bat. He says, if the matrix protein can prevent plaque when it's in a stent, why can't we give a matrix protein through medicine? Why can't we just eat this protein and it prevents plaque?
Good question. Good question.
Yes.
So the reason this is, you know, this is, you know, difficult to do is because where the matrix needs to be given, okay, is very important, right? Now, if you take it orally, it goes everywhere. Right. And remember, there is a lot of fluid blood in your body. You give matrix at a very high concentration also, you know, it will get diluted in your body and it will go everywhere. What you really want is matrix to be given at a particular site, the site where a plaque can form. Right. And you want it to be deposited just there.
No.
At the right. So that's what we are trying to do here. OK, so yeah. The location matters. Location matters.
Oh, yes, absolutely. Another question is, do we take the stent out? Is it remote controlled?
So the stent is more permanent now, right? So people who had a stent, for example, if you do, you know, an X-ray of their chest, you know, because it is metal, you will be able to see the stent. In some cases, right, depending upon where it is put. So it's a permanent structure, you know, they don't take it out, which is why, you know, finding ways to keep the stent functional for a long period of time becomes very important. If you just put a stent and you did not coat it with a matrix protein, they realize that over a period of time, that region has the ability to make new plaques. And then it becomes really difficult to treat it because there is already a stent there. And now it is getting, the stent is also getting blocked. So how do you, you know, prevent this situation or protect a person now, right? And that is why they thought of keeping a stent there, but making it more effective, which is why a coating of a stent came into play.
Okay. Anushita's question is that I heard from my parents that heart attacks in the past were rare. So is there anything that could have increased the amount of heart attacks in the present day?
Yeah, so there are many things that can contribute to this, right? I think the general health of our lifestyle is one major factor, right? You know, a lot of us are spending a lot of time sitting in front of a computer now, you know, and unless and until you consciously go out and do stuff, you know, physical activity, you know, chances are your heart is fairly sedentary, right? It doesn't, you know, you don't accelerate, you know, the working of your heart in any way, which is why, you know, if you go to a gym or you climb staircases, simple things like climbing a staircase, okay, to go up to home can be a simple exercise for your heart. you know, if you calculate your heart rate at the beginning and at the end of climbing about, you know, 4 or 5 stairs, floors, you have essentially asked your heart to beat faster, right? Which means your heart is being exercised. So the fitness of your heart matters, exercise matters, diet also matters. You know, what you eat, also matters. Particularly if you are not exercising, then, eating a healthy diet, is hugely important. But I think it's a combination of all these things. You should be eating well. You should also be exercising well. And you should stress less, right? I think we are all worried about everything now, and we worry about too many things. And sometimes that stress is, also contributing to how your heart feels. Okay? Thank you.